This is the body. This is the blood broken and poured out for all of us. In this communion, we share in His love. This is the body. This is the blood. For granted the sacrifice that set me free. I hunger and thirst for your love. Come fill me today. This is the body. This is the blood. I will remember everything, Lord, that you've done for me. I won't take for granted the sacrifice that set me free. We hunger and thirst for your love and your righteousness. We long for your presence here. This is the blood. This is the body.
Grace and peace to you in the name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. I welcome you to this service of worship and praise at First Presbyterian Church of Garland. It is good to be together in God's house. It is good to be together in the name of the Lord. Let us worship God.
Thank you. Let us be called to worship, reading responsively. We gather here in anticipation, seeking an encounter with our holy God, who comes among us when we least expect it, who invites us to wrestle with our questions and doubts, who richly blesses us and calls us each by name. Let us worship God together. Let us pray. Light of light, Lord of lords, God of this world and the next, we give you thanks for the promise of this day. We give you thanks for the challenge of this day. We give you thanks for the blessings of this day. Light of light, Lord of lords, God of this world and the next, we give you thanks. Amen.
If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves and the truth is not in us. If we confess our sins, God, who is faithful and just, will forgive us our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Let us confess our sins together. Gracious God, source of all life, Lord of mercy and grace, hear our prayer. We come before you in need of healing. The healing of our bodies and souls, the healing of our relationships, the healing of our pride and fear and apathy. We know that with you nothing is impossible, not even our healing, not even the restoration of the whole world. We pray that you will heal us, that you will heal our world, so that we will be freed to serve and love and dream and be as Christ calls us. Amen. The same God who blessed Jacob is the God who blesses us by forgiving our sin. The same God who gave Jacob a new name is the God who calls us children of God. We have seen God face to face, and our life has been preserved. Thanks be to God. Amen. Since God has forgiven us in Christ, let us forgive one another. The peace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you, and also with you. If you are worshiping with others this morning, you are invited to share the sign of Christ's peace with them. If you are worshiping on your own, I invite you to hold the peace of Christ in your heart.
Dear Christian brothers and sisters, as I'm going to tell you about my story as I know the Lord. I did not know my Lord and Savior at the early stage because I grew up in a family of 13. My father married 13 wives. We were so many of us. By then, there was a war in our territory by the time I was born. My parents have to run away from the war and get hide themselves in the bushes. So we did not have a chance at all to go to church. They do not even think anymore about God because we were all hiding in the bush. By that time, I was just a little. I was about 12 years old. All the way, we were hiding in the bush. When I reached 14 years of age, my parents have to send me to school. They did not get the chance to send me to school because there were no school in our bushes where we were hiding. So then, when I get married to my husband, my dear husband, he was the first person to teach me to know about alphabet. So he started teaching me. I gave birth to my first child. Then he reached the age of 5. He started going to school. When he came back home, I have to take his reader, began to learn. It's from there that I have the knowledge, a little knowledge that I have. And we were so many of us in that time as an illiterate children. Then they have to create an adult classes for us to learn. So again, a little bit knowledge from there. My husband start to teach me about God. I have a little knowledge about God. And truly, I can tell you that my first encounter with God was the time I gave birth to my third child. That was divine. Divine began to seek so much in the way that I couldn't know anything to do with. My husband go to the market to buy some drug. When he went to the market, the child was seriously ill. I took him to the altar and lay him there. I pray. I just try. Sincerely, I do not know whether I'm praying to real God or who. I ask God, if you are really a true God, help my child. If you rescue this child, I will give him back to you as your servants. I'm so happy right now because divine is saving God. So this is my joy about how I knew God. I have so much to tell you, but time will not allow me. But next time, I can try it. Thank you.
Let us pray. Almighty God, as we wrestle with your word, may we receive your blessing of knowledge, truth, and wisdom. Amen. The psalm lesson is Psalm 145, verses 8 through 9 and 14 through 21. Please listen for the word. The Lord is gracious and merciful, slow to anger, and abounding in steadfast love. The Lord is good to all, and his compassion is over all that he has made. The Lord upholds all who are falling, and raises up all who are bowed down. The eyes of all look to you, and you give them their food in due season. You open your hand, satisfying the desire of every living thing. The Lord is just in all his ways and kind in all his doings. The Lord is near to all who call on him, to all who call on him in truth. He fulfills the desire of all who fear him. He also hears their cry and saves them. The Lord watches over all who love him, but all the wicked he will destroy. My mouth will speak the praise of the Lord, and all flesh will bless his holy name forever and ever. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. The New Testament lesson is Romans 9, verses 1 through 5. Please listen for the word. I am speaking the truth in Christ. I am not lying. My conscience confirms it by the Holy Spirit. I have great sorrow and unceasing anguish in my heart. For I could wish that I myself were accursed and cut off from Christ for the sake of my own people, my kindred, according to their flesh. They are Israelites, and to them belong the adoption, the glory, the covenants, the given of the law, the worship, and the promises. To them belong the patriarchs, and from them, according to the flesh, comes the Messiah, who is over all, God blessed forever. Amen. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Our Old Testament reading is from the book of Genesis, chapter 32, verses 22 through 31. Let us listen for the word of God. That same night, Jacob got up and took his two wives, his two maids, and his 11 children, and crossed the ford of the Jabbok. He took them and sent them across the stream, and likewise everything that he had. Jacob was left alone, and a man wrestled with him until daybreak. When the man saw that he did not prevail against Jacob, he struck him on the hip socket, and Jacob's hip was put out of joint as he wrestled with him. Then he said, "Let me go, for the day is breaking." But Jacob said, "I will not let you go unless you bless me." So he said to him, "What is your name?" And he said, "Jacob." The man then said, "You shall no longer be called Jacob, but Israel, for you have striven with God and with humans and have prevailed." Then Jacob asked him, "Please tell me your name." But he said, "Why is it that you ask my name?" And there he blessed him. So Jacob called the place Peniel, saying, "For I have seen God face to face, and yet my life is preserved." The sun rose upon him as he passed Penuel, limping because of his hip. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Amen. Jacob was left alone. He had sent his family ahead of him, and he was all by himself, utterly alone. Deep, gnawing loneliness is a hard place to be for all of us, and certainly for Jacob, as he was about to confront his brother and his future. When we, like Jacob, are alone, we are cut off from all that is familiar. There is no one to cry out to, no one to comfort you, no one to rely on, no one to rely on you. It's just you and whatever is roiling inside of you. But Jacob was not alone for long. Without warning, a man, nameless and faceless, appeared and wrestled with Jacob until daybreak. Who was this man who joined Jacob while he was alone? What did he represent? What did he want? Whoever this man was, he was doggedly persistent. Persistent to death. He grappled with Jacob throughout the long and lonely night. Presbyterian pastor and novelist Frederick Buechner imagines the ordeal of this night-long wrestling match in his novel Son of Laughter. "Out of the dark, someone leaped at me with such force that it knocked me onto my back. It was a man. I could not see his face. His naked shoulder was pressed so hard against my jaw, I thought he would break it. His flesh was chill and wet as the river. I got my elbow into the pit of his throat and forced him off. I threw him over onto his back. His breath was hot in my face as I straddled him. My breath came in gasps. Quick as a serpent, he twisted loose, and I was caught between his thighs. The grip was so tight, I could not move. He had both hands pressed on my cheek. He was pushing my face into the mud, grunting with the effort." Who was this persistent and dangerous man? His identity is not revealed, so our imagination wrestles with possibilities. Maybe he was Jacob's brother Esau. A lifetime ago, Jacob had bargained for Esau's birthright. He had ruthlessly stolen his blessing as the elder son. And rather than face his brother head on and atone for what he had done, Jacob fled. He left Esau desolate and disinherited. Jacob knew a confrontation with his brother was inevitable because Jacob had sent word ahead to Esau that he was on his way. Maybe on the banks of the Jabbok, Jacob wrestled with Esau, the brother who resented him, the brother who hated him, the brother who was ready for vengeance. Surely Esau had enough rage to wrestle against Jacob throughout the night. Buechner continues with his description of this death match. Then he got me on my belly with his knee in the small of my back. He was tugging my head toward him. He was breaking my neck. Just as my neck was about to snap, I butted my head upward with the last of my strength and caught him square. For an instant, his grip loosened, and I was free. Over and over, we rolled together into the reeds at the water's edge. We struggled in each other's arms. He was on top, then I was on top. For the rest of the night, we battled. Each time I thought I was lost, I escaped somehow. Perhaps Jacob wasn't battling flesh and blood, but powers and principalities. Maybe his enemy that night was part of his own personality, a fearful piece of himself that lurked in the shadows. As the sun set that night, Jacob's most terrible and heinous flaw was on stark display. Jacob was alone that night because he was a coward. As he got closer to home and feared that his brother might kill him, Jacob devised a plan to preserve his life. Rather than face his brother head on, he devised a plan. He sent his wives and his children ahead of him. Maybe Esau would take pity on Jacob because he wouldn't want to harm this defenseless family. Or maybe Esau would exhaust his wrath by killing Jacob's family and in the end spare Jacob's life. Regardless of what Esau would do, Jacob committed the ultimate act of cowardice by placing his entire family in harm's way to save his own skin. Maybe through that long and lonely night, Jacob had to wrestle with this deep fear and self-preservation that even love for his family did not overcome. Maybe this terrible, fearsome wrestling match was a way for Jacob to confront and begin to conquer that which crippled him in daily life. Buechner continues to describe the battle. Then he was at me with new fury. For hours it went on that way. Our bodies were slippery with mud. We were panting like beasts. He outweighed me, he out-wrestled me, but he did not overpower me. He did not overpower me until the moment came to overpower me. I knew that all through the night he had been waiting for that moment. He had his knee under my hip. The rest of his weight was on top of my hip. Then the moment came and he gave a fierce downward thrust. I felt a fierce pain. I saw the pain as a dazzling bird shape of light. The pain's beak impaled me with light. It blinded me with the light of its wings. I knew I was crippled and done for. I could do nothing but cling now. I clung for dear life. I clung for dear death. My arms trussed him. My legs locked him. Jacob battles another inner demon, his own fierce, often damaging self-reliance on his cleverness, on his dogged ability to forge his own path. Jacob had always been a schemer. He had always been a trickster. He had always come up with a plan to get himself ahead. Through this, Jacob had prospered and grown powerful. But God was not calling Jacob simply to be an independent and successful self-made man. Rather, God had called Jacob to bear the covenant that God made with Abraham and Isaac and through them with all of creation. Jacob bore a calling that was bigger than himself, a calling that required him to fully and finally put his trust in God. In order to be the patriarch that God called him to be, in order to be the leader that the covenant demanded, Jacob had to face his own limitations. He had to conquer his relentless independence that denied a full, connected relationship with God. in order to walk by faith and not by sight, in order to live by every word that proceeded from the mouth of the Lord and not by his own cunning and wits, Jacob had to overcome his self-reliant way of being in the world. This wrestling match was Jacob's Gethsemane, that moment when he would have to declare, not my will, but thy will be done. As the day began to dawn and the struggle nearly over, Jacob sought a blessing. This time there was no trickery. There was no deception. There was only Jacob's desperate and clinging desire for this man to bless him. The man had no choice. He had crippled Jacob. He had bested Jacob, but Jacob would not let go. Let me go, for the day is breaking. I will not let you go unless you bless me, came the reply. Jacob knew that his very identity, his very life, depended on being blessed in this battle. And so the blessing began. The man asked Jacob what his name was. Jacob. Jacob the supplanter. Jacob the grasper. Jacob the usurper. But that name was too limiting, as Jacob was being called to take on the weight of God's covenant. So the man blessed Jacob with a new name and with it a new identity. You shall no longer be called Jacob, but Israel, for you have striven with God and with humans and have prevailed. Jacob would no longer be Jacob the supplanter. He would be Israel, the one who had struggled with God, the one who had wrestled with God, and the one who had prevailed. With such an identity, Jacob, now Israel, could take on the gravity of God's holy covenant. Before letting go, Jacob wanted to know this man's identity. Jacob wanted to know his name. The man deflected Jacob's question with a question of his own. Why is it that you ask me my name? The man would not tell Jacob. In this moment, it would have to be enough for Jacob to be blessed, to receive a new identity and a new direction. And then the man, the one who was Jacob's enemy, the one who wrestled out Jacob's inner demons, the one who was Jacob's God, departed. Jacob arose and crossed the river to join his family and meet his brother with a new identity, with a new blessing, a more whole soul, and a new limp. God's blessings that shape our lives and our purpose do not come easily. Such blessings demand that we struggle to let go of our old life and emerge into a new one. We must wrestle with our enemies whom we have allowed to define our lives. We must wrestle with those parts of ourselves that limit us and hold us back. We must wrestle with our God, who is not distant and aloof, but who is as close as our own breath and demands that our whole being be given over to God. We wrestle because we relinquish our feelings and flaws with great reluctance. We wrestle because that is how we learn to depend more and more on God. And as we wrestle and let go, God's blessings fill our lives. God blesses us with a new identity that enables us to fulfill the calling that God has placed on our lives. God blesses us with the courage and strength and wisdom that we need to live out that call. When God blesses us as God blessed Jacob on the banks of the Jabbok, we walk away with a limp. For we do not come up against our own existence without being changed. While none of us desire a limp, it is a sign that we have had an encounter with something truly profound and truly life-changing, and that we have come through it. God wrestles with us and blesses us, so that God might shape us to be the vessels for God's desired future. And in those struggles, God is with us, and we are never alone. Amen.
The affirmation of faith is the Apostles' Creed. Let us confess the faith of our baptism. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven, and is sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Let us pray. Heavenly Father, maker of heaven and earth, we praise and worship you for all your majesty, kindness, mercy, and your steadfast love for us. Thank you for this opportunity for us to be together today, though not physically, but with our minds, hearts, and voices in one place in your presence. Thank you for all your blessings, Lord, for our lives, for our loved ones, and for all that we have. Thank you for answering our prayers, for meeting our needs, healing us when we get sick, giving us company when we feel loneliness, for talking to us when we find ourselves in frightening silence and anxiety. We thank you for all of us who remained well during this pandemic. We praise you for all those who have recovered, and we pray for healing and speedy recovery for those who are still fighting this infection. We pray for the safety of frontline workers who are risking their own lives to save others. We pray for those who are facing financial hardships due to this current situation. Please help them and provide them with their needs. And we pray for the end of this pandemic now. Lord, please have mercy. We pray for peace and harmony in the whole world, for places where there are ongoing wars, and for the places where there is religious persecution. We pray for our extended church family, Lord, for the well-being of our elderly members, for those who are serving in the army and away from their homes. We pray for peace for those who have lost their loved ones recently. Give them courage, hope, and faith, Lord. We pray for the children who are staying home for a long time now, as they have not been spending time with their friends, neither they can participate in their church activities that they enjoy a lot. Help them, Lord, to be mentally focused on their goals and to learn more about you as they grow. We thank you for our pastors, elders, deacons, and members of all the ministry teams. We pray for your wisdom for them so that they may fulfill your will while taking care of the day-to-day matters of the church, while taking care of your people, and for being able to save souls for you. We pray for our country and its leaders, that they may lead the nation according to your will and make decisions that are in the best interest of the people according to your word, Lord. We ask this in the name of our Savior, Lord Jesus Christ. Amen.
Let us open our hearts and our lives and present our gifts to God, that all the world might know that we serve a great and a good God. Let us receive our offering.
us pray. Merciful God, we offer with joy and thanksgiving what you have first given us, ourselves, our time, and our possessions, signs of your gracious love. Receive them for the sake of him who offered himself for us, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
The Lord be with you, and also with you. Lift up your hearts. We lift them to the Lord. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right to give our thanks and praise. It is truly right and our greatest joy to praise your name, most holy God. You reveal yourself to us in countless ways, inviting us into the mystery of your inmost being. In your creation, you show us the marks of your hand. You call us to bear your presence into all the world. For your wondrous being and your glorious creation, we join our praise with the sound of all creation, who forever give to the glory of your name. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. You are holy, O God of majesty, for in your threefold glory we know Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord. Fully human, fully God, he was born an ordinary person in an ordinary time who yet showed your extraordinary grace. He proclaimed your coming kingdom in word and deed, challenging the powerful, healing the sick, and calling all people to live in light and life. Executed by the powers of the day, you raised him to new life to show that your power was stronger than death. He reigns in glory to show your presence to all people. Great is the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ shall come again. Lord God of our fathers, God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, open our eyes to see your hand at work in the world about us. Deliver us from the presumption of coming to this table for solace only and not for strength, for pardon only and not for renewal. Let the grace of this Holy Communion make us one body, one spirit in Christ, that we may worthily serve the world in his name. Keep us faithful in our service to you, so that we can continue to be the body of Christ in the world. Through Christ, with Christ, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor are yours, Almighty God, now and forever. Amen and amen. As our Savior Christ taught us, we are bold to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. The Lord Jesus, on the night of his arrest, took bread. And after giving thanks to God, he broke it. And he gave it to them and said, "Take and eat. This is my body, which is broken for you. Every time you eat it, do so remembering me." In the same way, he took the cup after supper, and he gave it to them and said, "This cup is the new covenant sealed in my blood. Whenever you drink it, do this, remembering me. For every time you eat this bread and drink this cup, you do proclaim the saving death of the risen Lord until he comes. These are the gifts of God for the people of God. Come, all is ready." The body of Christ given for you. the cup of the new covenant poured out for you. Let us pray. Almighty God, we give you thanks for this holy meal by which you nourish your people with eternal life and make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world. Send us now in unity as living signs of your kingdom to live and work in your peace for the peace of all. Amen. With Jacob, we leave this place with a new identity, with a new mission, with a new purpose, with God beside us. And so now may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us now and forevermore. Amen and amen.
Let us covenant together. Go forth into the world in peace. Have courage. Hold on to what is good. Return to no person evil for evil. Strengthen the faint-hearted. Support the weak. Help the suffering. Honor all persons. Love and serve the Lord, rejoicing in the power of the Holy Spirit.